Good morning, students. Today we will discuss about anatomy of external ear. So, as you all know that ear is an organ of hearing. Yes, ear is an organ of hearing, and the function of ear is not only for hearing aid or hearing purpose, but it is also concerned with maintaining the equilibrium of the body. Yes, if you have studied central nervous system, then you know that ear also plays an important role in maintaining the equilibrium of the body. I will not discuss that in detail in this video lecture. We will focus only on the external ear. And ear, as you can see in this figure, is having three parts, or is divided into three parts: the external ear, yes, the external ear, then we have the middle ear and the internal ear. Okay, so in this figure, the only the external ear is visible, which consists of two very important parts: the auricle or the pinna, and the external acoustic meatus or the external auditory meatus. Yes, so the external ear has two parts: the auricle, or also known as pinna, and the external auditory meatus. Yes, you can trace this in figure. Okay, now what is auricle or pinna? So what layman's known as ear, or what layman's generally calls as ear, is the auricle or the pinna. Yes, the auricle or the pinna is the part that is seen on the surface, or that is seen on the face. So this part of the ear, this part of the external ear, is the part that the layman calls the ear. Okay, and the greater part of this auricle is basically made up of a single plate of elastic cartilage, which is covered by skin on both the sides. Yes, you can see this, that the major part of this pinna, the you can say more than half or two-third, more than two-third part, two-third, above two-third part of this pinna is made up of a single complete plate of elastic cartilage, and this elastic cartilage is lined by or covered by skin. The lower one-third, not properly one-third, but the lower part, the lowest part you can say, of this pinna or auricle is very soft, and this part is made up of connective tissues, which is covered by skin and is known as or called as lobule. Yes, this lobule is that part on which the females used to wear earrings, or even in some communities the males also used to wear earrings. Okay, so the earrings is weared on this lobule part of the auricle or pinna. So talking about some other parts, talking about the rest part of the pinna, as you can see in this figure, the most prominent outwards border is called as this one, the outward border is called as helix. Yes, and the depression or the concavity just below the helix is called as scapha. Okay, now the most important one, the most important part to note is the concha. Yes, so this is the large depression on the pinna, which is called as concha, and this concha is responsible for accumulation, or for directing the sound waves towards external auditory meatus or external acoustic meatus. Okay, so concha is very important. It directs all the sound waves coming from different directions, and it directs or leads the sound waves to this external auditory meatus. Yes, you can see a conical projection on the just near this external acoustic meatus, or the cavity opening of this canal of external auditory canal. This projection, this conical projection, is known as tragus, and just opposite to this tragus we have an antitragus. Yes, So this is the tragus and this is the antitragus. Similarly, we have this is the helix, and then we have another fold. This is known as antihelical fold, and the most prominent part or the of this antihelical fold is the antihelix. So this is the helix and this is the antihelix, and this is a scapha. This is the most important depression or most prominent depression, large depression on the pinna, known as concha, which directs or which leads the sound waves towards this external auditory meatus. Now, talking about blood supply of auricle, so you can trace in this figure, the auricle is basically supplied by the posterior auricular artery. Yes, posterior, this is the posterior auricular artery, and this is the superficial temporal artery. So you can see that the blood supply is given by the posterior auricular artery and the superficial temporal arteries. Okay, so these two arteries chiefly supplies the arterial blood to the auricle. Yes, posterior auricular artery, you can see that the posterior surface or the medial surface is supplied by the posterior auricular artery, and the outer surface or the lateral surface is supplied by the superficial temporal artery. Now, talking about lymphatic drainage, so you can see that these are the pre-auricular lymph nodes and these are the post-auricular lymph nodes, and all the lymph will drain into these two groups of lymph node, that is the pre-auricular lymph node and the post-auricular lymph node, and some amount of lymph is also drained on the within the superficial cervical lymph nodes. Okay, so pre-auricular lymph nodes, post-auricular lymph node, as well as superficial cervical lymph nodes will drain all the lymph from the pinna or the auricle. Now, talking about the nerve supply, so the nerve supply is described to be divided on the two surfaces, the outer surface or the lateral surface and the inner surface or the medial surface. This is the lateral surface, this is the medial surface. Okay, so the lateral surface or the outer surface, the upper two-third part of this outer surface or lateral surface is supplied by the auriculotemporal nerve. Branch of the trigeminal nerve, the auriculotemporal branch of the trigeminal nerve. Yes, so this is the auriculotemporal branch of the trigeminal nerve, which is supplying the upper two-third part of the lateral surface of auricle. Now, the lower one-third, talking about the lower one-third part of the auricle, lateral surface of the auricle or the outer surface of the auricle. So you can see in this figure that it is supplied by the greater auricular nerve. Okay, root valleys C2, C3. Yes. So these are the nerve fibers arising from the greater auricular nerve, root valley C2, C3, which is supplying the lower one third part of the outer surface or the lateral surface of auricle or pinna. Now, talking about the medial surface or the posterior surface, so the upper two third, again the upper two third part, yes, this is the upper two third where I'm moving my cursor. So this upper two third part of the posterior surface or the medial surface of auricle is supplied by the lesser occipital nerve, root value C2, C3 again. So this lesser occipital nerve will supply the nerve fibers to the upper two third part of the posterior surface or the medial surface of the pinna, and the lower one third part of the posterior surface or the medial surface of the pinna is supplied by the greater auricular nerve again. Yes. So this is all about nerve supply and lymphatics of the auricle. Now we'll move on to external acoustic meatus or external auditory meatus. So this canal, this is the external acoustic meatus or the external auditory meatus. Yes, you can see it is labeled here. And this canal, basically this canal has very much importance in directing the sound waves from the concha towards the eardrum. Okay, so to the tympanic membrane, to direct the sound waves or to carry the sound waves to the tympanic membrane, there is a canal which is known as external acoustic meatus or external auditory meatus or external auditory canal also, and it directs or it conducts the sound waves towards the tympanic membrane. Generally, this canal is S-shaped. And talking about the outer part, first of all, you must know that this canal, this whole external acoustic meatus, is made up of both bony part and the cartilaginous part. Yes, talking about the lateral one third, this is the lateral one third or outer one third part. This is basically cartilaginous part, and the medial two third, talking about the medial two third part, this is basically the bony part. The length of this auditory meatus is around 24 millimeters, that is 2.4 centimeters, and out of that 24 millimeter, there the anterior 8 millimeter part is the cartilaginous part, and the medial 16 millimeter or the medial two third, that is the 16 millimeter part approximately, is the bony part. Yes. Now I have already told you that this canal is basically S shaped. Yes. So its outer part, this cartilaginous part, this part is directed basically directed medially forwards and upwards. Yes, you can see this is directed medially forwards and upwards. Okay. Then we have the middle part, which is directed medially backwards and upwards. Okay, medially backwards and upwards. Okay, like this, medially backwards and upwards. And then we have the innermost part, which is directed medially forwards and downwards, forwards and downwards, medially forwards and downwards. So this whole canal, this whole meatus is S-shaped, and in case of examining this meatus, that is why we have to draw this auricle or the pinna. We have to move the auricle or the pinna upwards, upwards, backwards, upwards, backwards, and slightly laterally to straighten this meatus, so that we can easily observe the tympanic membrane and the meatus clearly. Okay, so this meatus is approximately 24 millimeter in length. Outer 8 millimeter is the cartilaginous part. Inner 16 millimeter is the bony part, and is generally S shaped. Okay. Now, if you can see the canal in cross section, then you will come to know that the canal is generally oval in shape. This canal is oval in shape, and the greatest diameter of this canal is at the lateral end. You can see the greatest diameter is at the lateral end, and also the anteroposterior at the medial end. Yes, so medial end towards the medial end, and the this is the medial end, this is the lateral end. So anteroposteriorly, the medial end and the lateral end has the greatest diameter, and the bony part is the narrower part. Okay, and bony part as compared to cartilaginous part is also narrower, whereas the narrowest point, which is just 5 millimeter away from this tympanic membrane, the narrowest point, which is just 5 millimeter forwards from this tympanic membrane, is there, which is known as isthmus. Okay, so the isthmus of this external acoustic meatus is the narrowest part, which lies 5 millimeter forwards from this tympanic membrane. Now the bony part, which is formed, as I have told you, is formed of bone. So which bone? So this bony part is formed by the tympanic plate of the temporal bone. Yes, so the tympanic plate of the temporal bone will form this bony part, and this is generally C-shaped. If you can see this auditory meatus in cross section, you will come to know that the bony part will be C-shaped and is formed by the tympanic plate of the temporal bone. Now the posterior superior part of this plate is generally deficient, and here the wall of this meatus is basically formed by the squamous temporal bone. Okay, so a small part is also formed by the squamous temporal bone. Now you can see in this figure that this meatus is lined by skin. Yes, this meatus is lined by a very thin skin, which is adhered to the periosteum of this bony part. Yes, or the bone. So the periosteum of the temporal bone is lined by skin, which forms the in surface of this external acoustic meatus. Talking about the cartilaginous part, so this cartilaginous part is also C-shaped, as we have visualized in cross section, and the lining of skin here is adhered to the perichondrium. Okay, not periosteum, but perichondrium, the outer covering of this cartilage, the perichondrium. And this outer part contains hairs, some sebaceous gland, as well as ceruminous gland or the wax gland, okay, which produces wax. This ceruminous gland is nothing but modified sweat glands, okay. So in histology also you'll study various type of glands. So these ceruminous or wax gland is nothing but the modified sweat gland which is there in the cartilaginous outer one third, that is the cartilaginous part of this external acoustic meatus. Now talking about the blood supply of external acoustic meatus, so yes, the outer part of this meatus, this is the external acoustic meatus or external canal labeled here. Yes, this is the external canal. Now the outer part, you can see the outer part will be supplied by the superficial temporal artery. This is the superficial temporal artery. You can see it is giving branch to the outer part of this external acoustic meatus, and along with this superficial temporal artery, it is also supplied by this posterior auricular artery. Yes, so this posterior auricular artery and superficial temporal artery will supply the outer part of this external acoustic meatus, whereas the innermost part will be supplied by the deep auricular artery or the deep auricular branch of this maxillary artery. Yes, so you can see this is maxillary artery, this is the deep auricular branch of maxillary artery, and this is supplying the innermost part or the inner part of the external acoustic meatus. Lymphatics will be draining into the pre-auricular as well as post-auricular lymph node, and along with that superficial cervical lymph nodes too. Yes, so similar to the lymph drainage of the auricle, we have also the lymph drainage of external acoustic meatus. We have similar lymph drainage as of auricle, that is the all the lymph from the external acoustic meatus will be drained into pre-auricular, post-auricular as well as superficial or superior cervical group of lymph nodes. Nerve supply will be done by the two nerves, the auriculotemporal nerve, which is supplying the skin that is lining the anterior half of the meatus. Yes, the auriculotemporal nerve will supply the skin covering the anterior half of the meatus, and the posterior half of the meatus will be supplied by the auricular branch of the vagus nerve. Okay, yes, so these two nerves, the auriculotemporal nerve supplying the, this auriculotemporal nerve is the branch of the trigeminal fifth cranial nerve, and this will supply the anterior half of the meatus, and the posterior half of the meatus, the skin of the posterior half of the meatus will be supplied by this auricular branch of the vagus nerve, the 10th cranial nerve. Yes, now we will discuss tympanic membrane also very briefly here only. Tympanic membrane will not be a part of external ear, but tympanic membrane is a thin translucent membrane or partition which is basically in between the external acoustic meatus and the middle ear cavity. See in this figure. So, as I have already told you that the outer ear or the external ear is made up of two parts, that is the auricle and the external auditory meatus or external acoustic meatus. This membrane, this tympanic membrane is a translucent membrane, very thin translucent membrane, which is in between this external acoustic meatus and the middle ear cavity, okay, or the tympanic cavity. Yes, so you can also say that this is the barrier, this is the border of the external ear and the internal middle ear, okay. This tympanic membrane is oval in shape. You can see here, this is the tympanic membrane and this is oval in shape, and it measures around 9 by 10 millimeters and is placed very obliquely into this ear cavity. Yes, you can see it is placed obliquely and is forming an angle of 55 degree. It is forming an angle of, this is the angle of angle which is around 55 degree, and this is formed by the floor. This is the floor of this external acoustic meatus, and this tympanic membrane is forming an angle of 55 degree with the floor of this meatus. This tympanic membrane, as you can see, this is facing downwards. Yes, this is facing downwards, forwards, downwards, forwards, and laterally. Okay, now this membrane, this tympanic membrane has two surfaces basically. This is the outer surface which is visible here, and this is the inner surface to which the malleus is attached. Okay, So, talking about the outer surface of the membrane, first of all, so this outer surface of membrane is lined by skin. As you can see, this is this outer surface is lined by skin and is basically concave in shape. And the inner surface, as you can see here, this inner surface is convex and is providing attachment to the handle of the malleus. Yes, so this is the malleus bone, and the handle of the malleus is attached to the inner surface of this tympanic membrane, and this inner surface is generally convex in shape. Okay, now the point of maximum convexity, the point of maximum convexity lies at the tip of this handle. This is the manubrium of the malleus, and this at the tip of this handle there is the point of maximum convexity, which is called as umbo. Okay, so this is umbo, which is the point of maximum convexity. Now this membrane is basically thickened at its circumference. You can see this membrane is thickened at its circumference. Easily you can see this, the whole tympanic membrane is very much thickened at this, at its circumference, and its thickened part is known as annulus. Okay, now the this thickened part is basically fixed to the tympanic sulcus. The thickened part, the outer thickened part, is fixed to the sulcus at the temporal bone, basically on the tympanic plate. Okay, now superior to this the sulcus is deficient. Here the sulcus is deficient, and the membrane is attached to the tympanic notch. Yes, and from end to end, talking about from end to end notch, so you can see from the ends of the notch there are two bands. Okay, there are two bands. This is the anterior fold, this is the anterior band or the anterior malleolar fold, and this is the posterior malleolar fold. Okay, so this is the anterior malleolar fold and this is the posterior malleolar fold. Now you can see in this figure that greater part of this membrane is tensed or tightly stretched. Yes, that is why this greater part is known as pars tensa. Yes, the greater part, the majority of the part of this membrane is very much tense or tightly stretched and is therefore known as pars tensa, whereas the part which resides between this anterior and the posterior malleolar fold is known as pars flaccida, because this part is flaccid, or you can say is loose, and this is the most prominent part or most common part which is liable to be ruptured. Okay, this pars flaccida, as compared to pars tensa, pars flaccida easily ruptures. So the rupture of tympanic membrane easily occurs at this part, that is the pars flaccida, which is the part in between the two folds, that is the posterior fold and the anterior fold of this malleolar folds. Now talking about the structure of tympanic membrane, so if you section the tympanic membrane, then you can see that it has, or it is composed of three layers. It has three layers, or is composed of three layers. The outer layer is the cuticular layer, or the layer covered by skin. Yes, this is the outer layer, that is the cuticular layer, and this outer layer followed by just behind this outer layer we have the middle layer, that is made up of fibril. That is the middle fibrous layer. This is the middle fibrous layer, and you can see here that this middle fibrous layer has a superficial radiating fibers. These are the radiating fibers. Yes, superficial radiating fibers and deep circular fibers. Okay, so this middle fibrous layer, this middle fibrous layer is made up of superficial radiating fibers as well as deep circular fibers, and the circular fibers, as you can see, the circular fibers are very much minimal in the center. Yes, they are dense in the periphery, but very much minimal in the center. Talking about the pars flaccida, so you can see, or you can differentiate, that pars flaccida has no fibrous layer, but this fibrous layer is replaced by loose areolar tissue. So in case of pars flaccida has no fibers, no radiating fibers and deep fibers, deep circular fibers, but has areolar tissues instead of this fibrous layer, this middle fibrous layer. So the middle layer of this pars flaccida is made up of areolar tissues. Rest all the part of the pars tensa is made up of these middle five, this middle fibrous layers having these two radiating fibers and the deep circular fibers. The innermost fiber, as you can see here, the innermost layer is made up of, the innermost layer is made up of mucous membrane and is lined by columnar epithelium. Yes, you can see this is lined by ciliated columnar epithelium. Okay. Now, talking about arterial supply of tympanic membrane, so our tympanic membrane, our blood supply of tympanic membrane, the outer surface, yes, the outer means the lateral surface. First of all, I must tell you the surface or the surfaces are the outer or the lateral and the medial or the inner surface. So, going back, this is the outer surface, this is the outer surface or the lateral surface, and this is the medial surface or the inner surface to which the malleus, handle of the malleus is adhered. Okay, so arterial supply, venous drainage, lymph and nerve supply, all will be described under two heads, the outer surface or the lateral surface, and the inner surface or the medial surface. Okay, so moving on to the arterial supply of the tympanic membrane. So you can see in this figure, there are two branches, the anterior tympanic branch and the deep auricular branch, which is a branch of the first part of maxillary artery. So these two are the branches of from the first part of the maxillary artery, and these branches are basically supplying the blood, arterial blood, to the tympanic membrane. Now the outer surface is supplied by the deep auricular branch. This deep auricular branch will supply the blood, arterial blood, to the outer surface or the lateral surface of the tympanic membrane, whereas this anterior tympanic branch of the maxillary artery will supply the inner surface or the medial surface of this tympanic membrane. Okay, the inner surface is also supplied by the posterior tympanic branch of stylomastoid branch of posterior auricular artery. So we have posterior auricular artery. You cannot find posterior auricular artery in this figure. So in case of posterior auricular artery, there is a branch of posterior auricular artery, that is the stylomastoid branch. Yes, so you can find that into the blood supply of blood supply of external acoustic meatus. Yes, here. So this is the posterior auricular artery. Yes, and this is the stylomastoid branch. Getting it? This is the posterior auricular artery and this is the stylomastoid branch of this posterior auricular artery. So this stylomastoid branch again gives a branch that is known as posterior tympanic branch, and this again will supply the inner part or interior part or the inner surface of the tympanic membrane. Yes, so posterior stylomastoid artery, branch of posterior auricular artery, supplies the inner surface of the tympanic membrane. Now moving on to the venous drainage of tympanic membrane. So all the venous blood of the tympanic membrane from the outer surface will drain into this external jugular vein. Okay, so all the venous blood from the outer surface will drain into the external jugular vein, whereas all the venous blood from the inner surface will drain into the transverse sinus. This is showing the right transverse sinus. We have transverse sinus bilaterally, that is, we also have the left transverse sinus, and all the venous blood from the inner part or the inner surface will drain into this transverse sinus. Now the nerve supply of tympanic membrane will be in this will also be divided or discussed under two surfaces, the lateral surface and the medial surface. This lateral is the outer surface and this medial is the inner surface. So the outer surface, the anteroinferior part of this outer surface is supplied by the auriculotemporal nerve. Yes, this is supplied by the auriculotemporal nerve, whereas the posterosuperior part of this lateral surface of tympanic membrane will be supplied by the auricular branch of the vagus nerve. Okay, the auricular branch of the vagus nerve. Talking about nerve supply of inner surface, so this inner surface will be supplied by the tympanic branch of the glossopharyngeal nerve. Tympanic branch of the glossopharyngeal nerve through tympanic plexus. Okay, so you can see in this figure that all the part of this inner surface or the medial surface of the tympanic membrane will be supplied by the tympanic branch of the glossopharyngeal nerve through this tympanic plexus. So now we will move on to the most important part, clinically important part of this topic, that is external ear. So first of all, we'll go with the examination part. Yes, if in our day-to-day OPD practice, there is whole and soul only one principle to practice medicine successfully, that you must examine a patient first. If a patient arrives at you having certain complaints of involving different system, then after listening, being a homeopathic doctor, after listening or after recording his or her whole case, you must go with the examination part, because this is the most important part for any doctor of any system, and you cannot neglect or you cannot omit this part. Okay, so we'll also start with this important part in case of external ear. So the instrument which is used to examine the ear cavity or the external acoustic meters or the ear is the otoscope. Yes, you can see here, this is an otoscope, and this otoscope is the instrument which is used to examine the ear cavity. Okay, now you can see that the physician is inserting the otoscope within this external acoustic meatus, and is also, as I have already told you, that for examining the meatus, we have to, for examining the meatus as well as the tympanic membrane, we have to move the auricle slightly upwards, backwards, and laterally. So this, by lifting the auricle upwards, backwards, and slightly laterally, the S shaped of this meatus will become straight, and it's very easy for a physician to visualize the meatus as well as tympanic membrane. Okay, this, the movement of this auricle, that is upwards, backwards, and laterally, is in case of adult. However, in case of infants, the auricle is drawn downwards and backwards. Why? Because in case of infants, the meatus part is totally cartilaginous. Okay, there is no bony part. As I have already discussed in the external acoustic meatus, that the meatus has an outer cartilaginous part and inner bony part. But in case of an infant, the bony part, the bone is not developed. So the bony part, there is no bony part. There is totally cartilaginous part, or you can say the canal is only cartilaginous. So in that case, you have to move the auricle downwards and backwards. Okay. Now, while illuminating the membrane, tympanic membrane, for examination, when the physician illuminates the tympanic membrane for examination, the concavity of this membrane produces a cone of light. You can see here the concavity of this is the maximum point of convexity at the MO, and this concave, due to the concavity, the outer surface is concave. Yes, and this outer surface is visualized by us, by the physician. So as we throw light or as we illuminate the tympanic membrane, there is a formation of this cone of light over the entero-inferior quadrant. Okay, and this entero-inferior, basically you can see by these dotted lines, the 1, 2, 3, and 4, these are the four quadrants of the tympanic membrane, and this quadrant is the entero-inferior quadrant, which is the farthest or the deepest quadrant. Okay, and this cone of light, you can see, has its apex towards the umbo. Yes, you can see this cone of light has its apex towards the umbo, and through this cone of light, through this membrane, okay, we can visualize or we can see the underlying handle of the malleus. Yes, the underlying handle of the malleus, as well as the long process of the incus. Okay, so this is all about otoscopic examination. Now, why we used to examine the meatus or the tympanic membrane? So our next topic is the foreign body or wax impaction. Very commonly, you came to observe many patients having wax accumulation or impaction of wax within their external acoustic meatus. Okay, so if the wax, if the cerumen mass, you can see this is the cerumen mass or the wax which is impacted in this external acoustic meatus, this will generally be a source of excessive itching, and along with it, this also occludes this meatus, the canal of the external auditory canal. Okay, so due to which the hearing will be also impaired, and this impaction will be removed with the help of irrigation. Okay, you can say the cavity irrigation or the meatus irrigation, and in this irrigation we used to, or the physician used to, flush the ear, the ear cavity or the external acoustic cavity or the external acoustic meatus with water, with normal saline or water, with the help of a syringe. Yes, you can see this is the syringe, this is the tip of the syringe, and with this the physician will inject the jet of water, jet of normal saline, and with that jet, with that force, this cerumen mask or the wax mass will be drained off from this external auditory meatus. Okay, so foreign body or wax impaction is very common, and this troublesome wax impaction causes many symptoms like pain, itching, irritation, and loss of hearing or impaired hearing. Now moving on to another important term, that is the cauliflower ear. This cauliflower ear is a term which is also clinically known as, this cauliflower ear is clinically known as perichondral swelling. Okay, so this cauliflower ear is generally found, you can see in this figure, this is the ear having the cauliflower appearance, and these cauliflower ear or this appearance is generally or commonly found in boxers or in athletes, generally in boxers, or this cauliflower ear is sometimes, that is why also known as or called as boxers ears, because this is basically formed by the accumulation of blood within this auricle or pinna. Okay, so if the blood accumulate, and this blood accumulation will be due to any kind of injury. Yes, so any trauma or injury which causes hemorrhage or which causes internal hemorrhage within this pinna or the auricle, making it like a deformed ear. Yes, making it like a deformed auricle or pinna. So you can see why it is known as cauliflower ear. You can see the appearance of this ear. This ear is just like looking like a cauliflower, and this is very common in wrestlers, boxers, rugby players. Okay, so here this is basically nothing but the accumulated blood or accumulated you can say accumulated blood as well as some inflammatory exudates within this auricle, leading to a deformed external ear known as cauliflower ear or the boxer's ear. Okay, this is very common in sportsmen. So I have already discussed here with you all, because if someone came to you with this cauliflower ear, then first of all, while taking history, you must ask him or her about his profession. If he or she is an athlete, then you can easily came to know while examining this auricle or pinna that it is a cauliflower ear. When you palpate this cauliflower ear, or when you palpate this type of auricle, then you can see it appears to be spongy, and it appears to have fluid within this auricular cavity. Okay. Last but not the least, we have a term that is myringotomy. Myringotomy is a procedure in which there is an incision made on the tympanic membrane to drain any fluid or pus within the middle ear cavity. Yes, so you can see this is the middle ear cavity having the ear ossicles, and this middle ear cavity is filled with fluid here, or pus sometimes in case of infections. Generally, the middle ear cavity has air. Yes, you can see the normal ear is filled with air. The normal middle ear cavity is filled with air. But in case of certain infection, this middle ear cavity will have fluid or pus. And this, to drain this fluid or pus, the physician or the surgeon will incise this tympanic membrane. And this incision, the procedure of making an incision on the tympanic membrane is known as myringotomy. Now, the incision of this myringotomy is usually made at the posterior inferior quadrant of the membrane, because this quadrant is the most prominent quadrant. This is the most bulging and prominent quadrant, and it is very easy to give incision here. And one very most important thing is that on the inner surface or the medial surface of this tympanic membrane, the chorda tympani nerves run downwards and forwards. Okay, the chorda tympani nerve run downwards and forwards. So while making an incision on this tympanic membrane during myringotomy, the physician must be very careful that the chorda tympanic nerve may not get damaged. Okay, so the physician must be very careful while making an incision on this tympanic membrane during myringotomy. And this myringotomy is nothing but a surgical procedure to drain the pus or fluid from this middle ear cavity. The incision is made on the posterior inferior quadrant of the most bulging quadrant, the posterior inferior quadrant of the tympanic membrane. So this is all about external ear. In next video lecture, we will discuss about the middle ear and internal ear. Till then, stay home, stay healthy, take care. Thank you so much.